Doors opening. Going up.
Now it's time to tap it, unwrap it, and reveal the creme de la creme, the top of the pot noodle. Those 10 unforgettable ads created by men and women who must have had 3 shredded wheat on the day of their creation.
I think things go through certain waves, you know, like whereas in the 70s you had like blaxploitation, and like now I guess you could argue there's a queersploitation going on. At the time the Impulse ad came out, I think there was a real feeling in society at that time that, you know, gay was more acceptable, it was more mainstream, it was just on the cusp of film, like TV shows like Queer as Folk about to come out. There were a few stereotypes that were thrown in as cutaways to the ad, like you'd see Quentin Crisp sat there, you know, and baby dog with leather on it. But I think the positives far outweighed the negatives.
When I first got approached by Walkers, I was still trying to play football in Japan, albeit spasmodically, I have to say. And my agent got hold of me and said that when you come home, they want to do a special ad to sort of celebrate the fact. Welcome home. I was outside the station, Leicester Station, shooting this bit with a newspaper vendor. And there were a lot of people watching, as you can imagine, in the town centre. A little old lady comes over to me and she taps me on the shoulder. She says, are you Gary Lineker? I said, yeah, that's right. She says, well, I thought it was. She said, what's going on here? Are they expecting anybody special?
The twist we gave it was he was known as Mr. Nice Guy because he'd never been booked in all his career. We thought it'd be interesting to turn him into a nasty guy who pinched crisps because they were so irresistible. Welcome home. Welcome.
Come on in and close the door. Well, Walkers are part of PepsiCo, obviously an American company, and I think when they first went to them with the idea, I think A, they didn't know who the hell I was, and B, they thought, how can you, you know, do this thing where he's actually taking the chance? Chris, at the end, this is an incredibly cruel ending.
They said, you can't have an English sporting hero being a thief. Come on. And we said, everyone will know it's a joke. You don't have to worry about it. Oh, you can't do that. And they tried to force us to shoot the ending where he gives the crisps back to the kid. But we ignored that.
There's no more Mr. Nice Guy.
They still can't understand how we did it and how English people don't go against him because he pinches kids' crisps.
I've done ads with the Spice Girls. I did one with Ulrika Johnson, which was particularly tough, having to lie on top of her for half a day. And Gazza, likewise, we did one with him. I remember they put this contraption in where it came over his ears and right under his eyes and it spurted out of the water. Well, when they initially did it and we started, we just couldn't do it for laughing. It was just hilarious.
Welcome home. He's very natural, you know, and he's not an actor, but gradually he's got more and more confident. And, you know, he's as good as any actor that I work with now. He's just fair, and he knows exactly what to do. He knows how to hold the crisp perfectly. And, you know, and he won't be ever caught with a packet of Golden Wonder. You know that about Gary.
When we did those early Hamlet commercials, they were always the most fun things to do because there was no set of rules. You know, in the end, you just took what was the most ridiculous or wonderful situation, and then there was suddenly the product at the end of it.
Happiness is a cigar called Hamlet.
But I think that, you know, we were using humour and in a way that no one else was, and so the commercials stuck out.
It is that thing of when something goes wrong, this was satisfaction, this would get you over the hump. Always the best campaign ideas in advertising is when it's very simple and where you can put it into any area. You can borrow from any area, whether it's films, theatre, real life.
Happiness is a cigar called Hamlet, the mild cigar.
Don't start the talking. I could talk all night.
We went down to Wardour Street, to a cave in Wardour Street. So I took my son, Elvis Costello, as he is now, who's then called Declan Patrick McManus. We were in a club, and obviously the idea was that there was no better drink than our White's lemonade to quench your thirst in this hot atmosphere. And we were dressed up in T-shirts with the band name on, which was The Thirst.
I'm a secret lemonade drinker.
Always.
I'm a trying to give it up, but it's one of those nights.
Always
lemonade.
I did more than one voice. I did the bit about the secret lemonade drinker, the Presley voice.
Always lemonade.
And when we rode out, I said to Declan, let's do it like the Beatles. So we did the Liverpool noise, because both of us have got a Liverpool background. And we did the,
Even as a kid, I always used to like the idea about White's lemonade, because it seemed like so non-corporate compared to, say, Coca-Cola or, you know, McDonald's, which are these huge multinationals. Our White's lemonade, I never knew where that had come from. And who was our White? And it always used to conjure up this idea of a bloke in his shed, you know, distilling it, while his wife would say, come on in now, our White, your tea's ready.
I'm a secret lemonade drinker.
Our White's, our White's.
I'm trying to keep it up, but it's one of those nights.
Our White's,
our White's. Our White's lemonade. I'm a secret lemonade drinker.
Our White's.
Always lemonade.
Always
lemonade.
The ad was running at a cinema, it prefixed a movie, and I hadn't seen it on the telly at that point, so I went to the cinema just to see the ad. Combined with the music, I mean, Marvin Gaye's heard it through the grapevine, it just all sort of came together, this very kind of hormonal, sexy, pubescent dream for me, really. And I mean, Nick Kamen was just sex on legs. Pair of jeans that you didn't really need. Suddenly they became a must-have item. And yeah, I mean, I only wanted them because Nick Kamen wore them. there wasn't really life after Levi's for Nick Kamen because he broke the golden rule. He talked. Totally demystified him. You know, him running around singing this rather rubbish pop song did so little for me, and it was like, next!
Of pure cream.
When the first ad came out, it was so different to any other ad that you saw on telly. The shock element at the end, I remember thinking what great ads they were.
By heck, you smell gorgeous tonight, pal.
It was a very sophisticated way of showing a northern drink, and it worked. I was modelling when I was first asked to be in the Boddington's advert. I'd been modelling for about 7-8 years, I think it had been, and it was just like any other day. It was a request, a casting for a commercial, and I was up north doing a catalogue shoot, and I got the facts of the script for the ad, and I read it, and I just thought, this is so perfect for me.
The body is new.
It was a spoof on a Calvin Klein commercial. It was shot in Malibu in a huge house. And basically I had half-naked men walking around all day, these gorgeous models, and me in a white flowy dress. It was like a dream come true, and I just had a marvellous time.
If you think that's strong, Chuck, try lifting one of these. Hey, Tarquil, your jollies aren't right way around.
And I knew something would happen to me once the advert was on because they'd been so high profile in the past. But I didn't quite know what, and I thought, you know, maybe it'll just be a few more modelling jobs. I didn't think for a second I would end up doing television.
Total amount of coffee drunk by the Big Breakfast team this year.
In cups?
Yeah, in cups. It's done in pints.
It's
this
done
is.
In pints.
Probably easier for you to work out, I know you're both.
Do you want a flake in that, love?
Sound running when you're ready.
At 4, an example of a programme that started off on Channel 4 before being turned into a series of classic ads.
Aye, they're grotty and everything, but the Turpins seem to get a good side. They've got a big waterfall and big pools to play around in. There's lots of them there. They looked really happy.
The agency wanted just one locked-off shot showing a character chatting to an interviewer, basically.
Oh, it's good to come back into a warm flat after you've just done a run, and it's always nice to come into somewhere warm if you've been freezing to death outside on a 10-mile slog.
They weren't scripted at all. We just went out and looked for people who might be suitable, who were just very chatty. So I went to this guy called Frank. He'd lived in Bristol for about 20 years, and he comes from Bolton, I think, and he hadn't changed one minute iota of his accent at all, and just recorded him in his flat.
They should be sort of fairly modern in design, and they got to be easily turn off and honourable.
The family that actually owned the corner shop around the, just down the street from the studio, we made them into penguins.
Oh, yeah. Yes, they are easy to clean. They just wipe
over. Wipe over, and it looks
that's
like
right.
New.
It looks good. And
not like some of these other things, you know, that are just there to, you know, oh, this looks pretty in my kitchen. You know, it's there to do its job, and it
does it well.
The only limitation was that they had to talk about electricity because everybody thought they were for gas. And that's perhaps the only failure of the adverts. People still refer to them as the gas adverts.
You know, having grown up in Brazil with a lot of fruits and in a good climate, the temperature is very important. I wouldn't be able to sit on my chair if I'm shivering and feeling damp. That's when the electrical heating comes into the picture. It's like the last piece of the jigsaw. Well, it is. It's very comfortable, affordable. Comfortably affordable.
Hello, Tony. I think we might use a video replay here.
Super, Ralph. Let's do that.
Oh, yes, we could be in for a quintessential Tango Taste sensation here.
It was meant to be taking the mickey out of other ads that were on the TV at the time, like the coffee ads that are out there and stuff like that. You have a drink and you go, ooh, whoopee, and flowers bloom. And we decided to express this in a really OTT fashion.
Why, yes!
It started with a punch in the mouth, funny enough, because we was trying to do it as kind of stupid and slapstick as possible. Then it moved to a kick up the ass for obvious reasons. And then for that, it was still deemed as being too aggressive. So it went on to being sort of Morecambe and Wise-esque little tap on the cheeks.
Why, yes!
The guy we used, he was like a Shakespearean actor. He was the one who made us laugh the most. It was, we wanted someone who was obviously big and bold.
It's the way he moved as well. It was physically how he ran. It's just surreal.
It just illustrates the bite and buzz. Oh!
The guy that was being slapped, he was really good, actually. Again, I thought he was a really good actor. And he was just the best at reacting to being hit. He never made a big deal out of it. A lot of the actors were like, oh, God, I've been hit, you know, and it's just like, he just did it very cool and very kind of slightly dopey.
Let's look again.
It sparked a playground craze. And, you know, people used to go around sort of slapping each other saying, oh, you've been tangoed. And it was all very entertaining and great fun, and there was no problems until we got a phone call one day from a surgeon who said, look, I'm not, you know, the complaining type, but I thought you'd like to know that I did an operation on a child this morning with a perforated eardrum, and I was wheeling him into the operating theatre on the gurney and said to him, what happened to you then? And he said, I got tangoed, Gov. And, I mean, OK, it's funny, but we pulled the ad that afternoon. And what we did is changed it to the kiss. So instead, the genie rushed up and planted a kiss on the bloke instead, which worked just as well.
You know where you've been tangoed.
What's the good of a beautiful banger without
cut out memories?
Chicken won't ring bells with a pile of something else if it's not
out.
If an alien came from another planet and saw someone bothering to clean up a potato, peel it, boil it for 20 minutes, mash it all up, then put it on a plate, when they can just pour hot water on a powder and serve it, they'd think we were mad. And from that developed the script.
On your last trip, did you discover what the Earth people eat? They eat a great many of these. They peel them with their metal knives. Boil them for 20 of their minutes. Then they smash them all to bits. They are clearly a most primitive people.
We are building the sets up on 6-foot rostrums with 3 puppeteers per Martian. Underneath with all these calipers.
Captain, something strange has appeared on the Earth scanner. Let me observe.
They moved pretty crudely, with levers that went down through a platform. And underneath this platform were loads of blokes pulling levers which turned the head, lifted the arm, or opened the mouth, or swiveled the eyes around. It was all pretty crude, but it was part of their charm, I think, that they were crude.
After the day's labours, how nice to come home to the wife. A pair of slippers and a plate of Cadbury's Smash.
The director at the time, Bob Brooks, was well known for being short-tempered. And he used to let fly at the Martians, saying, what the hell are you doing at the back? Will you pay attention?
All the puppets, the puppeteers, were taking the mick out of the direction, what have you. And the guy and had all these puppets lying in their spaceship, all lying around. And they were sort of talking in American voices and doing jokes. Which, and they started to make them laugh. That's great. We should do that. And that's how it happened.
For MASH, get Smash.
Well, we had this little gimmick of having the S drop down to MASH, for MASH, get Smash, and we wanted a jingle to get it in people's heads. So we went off to see Cliff Adams, who was top jingle writer at the time.
And he said the idea, he said, is it's for MASH, get smash. So do you think you can do anything musically? And I said, yes, I think so. I said, we could, for instance, I said, do something like...
Dang, 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 dang. It was perfect.
I said, no, John, that's not it. That's... I was illustrating what we could do. And he said, no, I don't want any more. Just do that.
You know, in a millisecond, he'd done something which ran for 10 years. And he got money from it every time it played.
And then what better than to curl up satisfied in front of your favourite comedy programme?
And after peeling all for 20 minutes...
Or MASH, get smash.
Unlike the Duracell rabbit and the Goldblend couple, we've gone on and on and on for long enough now. In short, the end is nigh. I do hope you've enjoyed our starry odyssey. But if you're not completely satisfied, then do please return it in the original wrapper stating when and where you bought it. Remember, contents may settle during packaging, investments can go up and down, and that your home may be repossessed if you do not keep up repayments. For full details, see last week's TV Times. In the meantime, we leave you with an ad that you obviously thought was good for you. The TV commercial that polled more votes than any other in our top 100. A classic? I should say so.
I suppose it's the equivalent of filming an avalanche. To be in front of an avalanche as an avalanche is careering towards you. It's that sensation, I'm sure. I mean, what we want to do is create something which is kind of emotionally arresting and visually arresting and having just something quite epic and quite extraordinary to happen on a TV screen.
He waits. That's what he does.
We were just kind of inquisitive about how the product worked, and we didn't really understand about the weight. So we kind of went through a few bars and we kind of looked at the way they did it, and we actually timed it. We worked out that it takes 119.5 seconds to pour a pint of Guinness, or to pour and then wait for it to settle. So then we thought, that's quite interesting. Good things come to those who wait. Just like you have to wait for a pint of Guinness, you have to wait for a wave.
Experts on the end of phone lines telling us where the waves were expected and where various sets were going to come in and on what shore. So you'd sort of, it was unplannable as a shoot, really. You just had to be out there and wait until you knew where the surf was coming in that was going to be sizable enough to film. We didn't want the perfect face. We wanted people who looked like they'd genuinely wait for this extraordinary wave, and only they would know where it was going to come. The guy who stars in it, who's not really a very good surfer, he was very out of condition, which we liked. I mean, we found him under a palm tree on a beach. So we put him on 40-foot waves and he looked terrifying.
A real Polynesian surfer waiting for the most amazing wave of his life, and that's what it is. And then it becomes what's in his mind's eye. The horses become symbolic because they become the experience of riding a 60-foot wave and what it is in his head.
We needed to shoot the horses in a certain way that obviously worked with the image underneath. You'd have jumps set up against blue, and you'd have these white horses jumping repeatedly over these fences, and you'd set your camera and your lens at a certain position, and hopefully the two pieces would composite together.
He waits. That's what he does. And I tell you what, tick followed tock, followed tick, followed tock, followed tick. Ahab says, I don't care who you are, here's to your dream. The old sailors return to the bar. Here's to you, Ahab! And the fat drummer hit the beat with all his heart. Here's to waiting.
Well, it's obviously not going to get sold in 5 minutes, so what do you say we put you up here for the night? You can sleep on it and come back to it in the morning. We've got a spare double bed upstairs. It's never been used, so no problem with sleeping arrangements.
I know what I need. The fan in Glade Circulaire. It's the only air freshener with a fan to circulate the fragrance throughout the room, so everyone can enjoy it. Circulaire from Glade, breathing life into your home.
Oil, food, hair.
No wonder your sink water drains slowly.
But Mr. Muscle Active Foamer has two liquids that combine to create a powerful foaming force that clears the whole pipe and gets your drains back to full speed. Mr. Muscle Active Foamer loves the jobs you hate.
Oh, nice glasses, Mike.
From Specsavers.
I bet they're reasonable then.
Well, that's not all. Have a look at these. Free second pair, 2 for 1.
Very nice, Mike.
They're both very focal.
Yeah? Great.
So it's... Should have gone to Specsavers!
Yeah. Now, Mike. We all did.
If I could have that report by 2, please. Brian?
The fragrance of lavender and chamomile. The soothing fabric conditioner in new bold 2-in-1.
Whatever you need, I can help you, but you're going to have to trust me.
This is a bad guy who needs to put away.
He could hurt somebody else. Now you need to tell us where he is.
Brand new Law and Order Criminal Intent and Special Victims Unit.
Police! We have a search warrant!
The new Law and Order Double Bill coming soon. Hallmark, Channel 190.
V plus one here, and then close the back.
Halfords, bank holiday specials store-wide. Like this Britax Freeway City Stripe, only half price while stocks last. And we'll fit it for you free at Halfords now.
At Courts, enjoy up to 50% off dining.